हेलो।
या प्रारब्ध दिस साइड।
या तो आर यू अवेलेबल नाउ?
या आई कैन अटेंड।
ओके ओके, तो शैल वी स्टार्ट?
या
तो यू मेंशन टू प्रोजेक्ट इन योर रिज्यूमे, राइट?
या
इसको सप्लाई चेन एंड क्लाइंट कॉस्ट।
या
ओके, तो व्हाई आर यू इन माइक्रो सर्विसेज हियर?
माइक्रो सर्विसेज बेसिकली लाइक टू यू नो टू लाइक ब्रेक द प्रोजेक्ट इनटू स्मॉलर कंपोनेंट्स
या
सो
तो एट एंड यू कैन यू डू दिस वेब सर्विसेज, राइट? व्हाई आर माइक्रो सर्विस?
ओके सो लाइक वेब सर्विसेज बेसिकली वी यूज व्हेन लाइक अ क्लाइंट इज बेसिकली समवन हु हैज टू कंज्यूम यू नो नॉट फॉर द रिप्रेजेंटेशन पर्पसेस ही हैज टू कंज्यूम डेटा. So, like REST services are just like if there is a like a thing which is consuming data for some computation purposes basically. But like microservices, we can even like even the normal code can consume data and like use this data for you know representing it on UI or parsing it. So
So
like
microservices will also, you will expose it, right? It will be kind of service only.
yeah.
You will expose kind of REST services only.
Yeah, but like according what I understand, like why we are using is basically like the difference basically in the way in which we want to consume the data. So like basic purpose of REST is to consume data, you know, not to interpret it much, but you know. In microservices, we can even pass the data and you know throw it to the UI layer.
Which microservices you are using?
Sorry.
Which microservices you are using?
So basically, we have like there are certain you know we have broke our project into certain microservices like for election there is a microservice, for allocation there is a microservice, you know, for
Okay,
functionality wise.
which service you are working on?
I am like working on scrubbing and election basically.
Okay, so this scrubbing and election.
Yeah.
Okay, so if you make it a REST service, will there be any problem?
Yeah. So basically, yeah. So I don't have actually much clarity on this, but from what I understand is like again as what I said initially that the data which like here the APIs are there which actually can you know return specific things, but in REST we have to return the specific entities that we have created in REST in JSON or XML form.
Okay. Where are you using multi-threading in your project?
Multi-threading is basically like so if we have like multiple incoming requests, so basically to handle each like not to for each request there is a separate thread, but yeah, we have a thread pool which is basically like which basically like continuously polls in for the queue for available corporate actions that are there in the queue and process them.
No, one second. You are using queue or multi-threading?
We are using thread pool to you know process the corporate actions that are there in the incoming in the system. So basically each corporate action like is submitted to the task of the thread pool and that is basically picked up by a thread pool thread to process eventually.
No, see, thread pool will contain some threads. That's
Yeah.
it.
Yes. And basically threads are there, but we have to submit the task. You know, there is a basically a queue. Like basically we are
Yes,
submitting the task.
queue you will submit. So which queue you are using?
So like we are not explicitly using, we just submit our task to the thread pool, but
Okay.
internally the thread pool is using like what I've read is internally it uses a blocking queue.
Okay, it's using blocking queue.
Sorry?
it's using blocking queue, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So, do you know what is blocking queue?
Yes, I know.
What is it?
Blocking queue is basically a thread-safe version of queue. So, multiple threads can safely operate on it without causing concurrency issue, as well as, if we have a, say, put operation, and if it is a, say, array blocking queue. So, array blocking queue is fixed in size. We have an upper bound. And if it is full, and if a, like, thread is trying to put something into it, and it finds it is, full, it will block. And same is with, if the size is zero, and some thread is trying to consume some data, it finds that the queue is empty, it will block again.
So, at a time, you are executing only one thread?
No, multiple threads can operate. Mm-hmm. It's not the case that one thread, but it's basically there won't be any concurrency issue. Plus, we would be we don't have to internally, it uses these conditions which I'm telling to mm-hmm. just to make sure that we don't try to consume data which is not present, or we don't try to put data when the queue is already full. So, if we would implement it, we would have to handle these cases. Internally, this is in turn handled by these queues, these blocking queues.
How are you handling the at the receiver end?
So you are asking how is it internally implemented in this?
Yes.
This queue has a certain size if it is an array blocking queue. So before putting the task, we would check. Basically, there would be a condition if size is equal to the max size that we would have defined while initializing the queue. If it is the case, then we would call wait. Okay. And similar is the case when we are trying to get something out of the queue. We would check if the size is zero, then we have to wait. And once the producing, if it is not full, it will produce and it will call notify all. So
you are using this blocking queue just to limit the threads?
So as I told, we are not explicitly using it. We are using thread pools that in turn uses this blocking queue.
Okay. So you are using thread pool.
Yeah.
And how are you getting the thread from the thread pool?
We don't get, actually we submit the task to the thread pool and
That's what happens after that?
Okay, so what happens is, if say we have a fixed thread pool, of 10 threads, so thread pool will say we are submitting the first task and it finds that the first thread is free. So the first task would be assigned to the first thread. Now we are submitting second task, the second thread. Similarly, we put up 10 tasks and 10 threads are simultaneously working on these tasks, 10 tasks. Mm-hmm. Now the 11th task comes in and the thread pools find that all the threads are busy executing the task that I have already submitted. So no thread is free. So it will be put up in the queue, and once a thread finishes the task, say the fifth thread finishes the task, it would return back to the thread pool and check in the queue that any other task is there. If it is there, it will pick this task and it will start executing it.
What is executor service?
So executor service is a service which is helping us to achieve this. So it is an implementation of executor framework interface.
In your scenario, could you use executor service?
Sorry, can you please repeat your question?
Yeah, in your scenario, could you use executor service?
In which scenario? Sorry?
In your scenario, in your project.
Okay, so as I told, for corporate actions, we are using this executor service. So, what happens is, we are capturing this corporate actions from outside. And once we get it, we submit it to this executor service, the thread pool that we have created through this executor service. So that is basically a handle to the thread pool, and we are submitting our task, which is in the form of corporate actions, to this thread pool.
Okay. Tell me, let's say there are three threads, T1, T2, and T3.
Okay.
Okay. How can you make them run one by one? So once first is finished, then second should start, and then second is finished, then third should start.
Okay, so basically we have to use join method, which is there in like thread APIs. So basically T1 thread has to have a handle of so T1 has to finish first. So T2 need to have a basically a handle or a reference to T1 thread, and it will like call T1 dot join before finishing. So this ensures that T2 will
Before
wait
finishing,
until T1 finishes.
how
And
will you come to know it's about to finish?
sorry.
How will you come to know if T1 is about to finish?
So the join method, like the thread will go into waiting state, waiting for the thread 1 to finish. And once it finishes,
Tell me the
it
code. Let's say there are T1, T2, and T3 threads are there.
will. Okay.
Tell me when you will start and when you will put join over there.
Okay, so like what exact scenario is that first T1 should finish, then T2 should finish, and then T3 should finish, right?
Yes.
And is it the case that T2 should not even start before T1 finishes? Like, is the output of T1 relevant to T2?
Yes.
Okay, so before, like in the run method of T2, the first statement would be T1 dot join. So basically, once like the main thread starts the T2 thread, the run method would execute, and the first statement it would encounter is T1 dot join. So this will signal to thread T2 that I should wait before T1 finishes its task. So it will
So
go.
in run method, so the this run method, right?
Yeah.
How will you get the reference of T1?
Okay. So basically this thread must be some runnable task, right? So it can have a variable of thread type, and from the main thread, while initializing this thread to this runnable task, we can like pass the reference of thread 1 to the constructor. Are you getting me? Like what I said? So yeah, so we can like basically pass that reference of thread T1 to this thread second runnable task via constructor, and then use this handle in the run method.
Okay. So this run method will be okay. So in this run method, you will do T1 dot join.
Yes.
Okay, then.
Then once basically once the thread T1 finishes, it will automatically come out of the waiting state, waiting for T1 to complete. And then once the JVM schedules this T2 thread, it will also complete its run method. Like once the JVM schedules it's in running state, it will execute its run method and will eventually.
So then T2 and T3 both will start, right?
Yeah, but in T3 again we can put T2 dot join. So
So T3, T1, T2 both use the same run code.
But they would have a different handle, right? So while creating T3, the like while creating T2, we pass the reference of T1. So while creating T3, we can pass the reference of T2, right? Because it's basically calling the current, like the instance variable that I've
What do you
maintained.
mean by handle here?
So if we would have an instance variable of thread type, say the or runnable type, right? And we are when
So
we are
let's say this T1 in the let's say there is one thread, my thread, and which implements runnable.
Yeah, okay.
Okay. Now tell me, and inside that we are creating one method which is run.
Okay, so I am telling you, yeah. So say let's our class is runnable or run, say
Runnable.
runnable.
And
Okay.
inside that we are creating one run method.
Yeah.
Now tell me what I should do inside this run
Yeah,
method.
so I'm telling you, we would have an instance variable in this runnable class, right? And that,
Instance variable of my thread, the class that we created.
yeah, exactly.
Okay.
And
Which I created. Okay.
there would be a constructor, right?
We'll create one constructor inside this.
And that would have like this instance variable value passed from outside. Basically, while creating this runnable task object, we would pass this instance.
What is the constructor in this? I mean, argument in this constructor.
Of the same type class.
My thread.
Yeah.
Okay.
And this instance variable would be initialized with this argument value that we are passing to this constructor.
Okay.
And in the run method, we would use handle like this instance variable dot join.
Okay.
Yeah. So while creating thread T2, we would have passed reference of T1, and while creating T3 task, we would have passed reference of T2. And since in the run method we are calling the instance variable dot join, so it is like we are not actually specifying. So it is a generic type of code which can work for both threads.
Okay, let's move to next question. Can you tell me what is the difference in class not found exception and no class def found error?
Class not found exception, so like when we do class dot for name and we put in say a third party library, say com.mysql.jdbc, and the class is not actually there, so we get the class not found exception at runtime.
So if class is not there means if it is not present at the runtime, then it will give class not found exception, right?
Yeah.
Okay, and when we'll get no class def found error?
So no class def found error is like, actually like I have tried it in my local machine. So if there is a class A and it has a class B also, and A has a dependency on B. So during compile time, like I had this B compiled and there was a B.class file present. So it compiled fine. But once I like deleted it from my machine, b.class file, and run the a.class file using a Java command, then it gave no class def. So basically at compile time it was present, but at runtime we were not able to find the definition.
Okay, are you confused with both the things? Which one is compile time and which one is runtime? Are you sure the class not found exception is runtime?
Yeah, class dot, yeah, because yeah, so I've written a code and it was during runtime that I got class not found exception.
Class not found is runtime. Okay.
Basically, and in class not found exception, the difference is like we are actually directly during runtime we are trying to load a class dynamically. And we are basically at runtime directly, like we are using class dot for name, so it is not checking during compile time that whether the class was present or not. When we execute the code, it like dynamically tries to get that class, say of JDBC driver, and it does not found, it gives the class not found exception at runtime. And like no class def found error is basically the class was present at compile time, the compiler made sure that the class was there, it had reference to this dot class file, but actually during runtime it was not able to find that particular class.
So if class is loaded by the class loader at the compile time, why do you think it will not present at the runtime?
As I told, like what I did on my local machine was there were two classes A and B, and like A had a reference to B, so like during compile time both the dot class files were created and the class loader was successfully able to find the b.class file, right?
So why it will not find at the runtime?
Because
class loader loaded it. What can be the reason it did not find at the runtime?
Okay, like yeah, this I have not explored. I actually deleted it on my machine like manually, so yeah, this is, I am not sure like how, like what can be other possible reasons that that is not able, it is
you,
not able.
You understand how the class loader works, right?
Yeah, I understand.
Class loader, if it finds the class, it I mean Java file, it will create a class file, it will load the class, right?
Yeah.
And if it loaded the class, nobody removes it, right? The class will be there always.
Yeah.
And if its class is there, then why at runtime it's not able to find?
I'm not sure on this actually. Yeah, I've never explored this.
Okay, no problem. Okay, so let's say there is one parking lot.
Okay.
And this parking lot has six floor.
Okay.
Okay. And you can take pen paper. And
I have a pen and paper with me.
Okay. So you have to create the design in object oriented manner.
Okay,
so that we follow the OOPs principles, right? So you just need to tell me first what and all object you will create for this parking lot and what will be the operations inside that.
Okay, can I take 2 to 3 minutes to think over this?
Yeah, sure, sir. Take
okay. So, sorry, are there any more conditions like which I need to consider or I need to design a simple basic parking lot?
Basic parking lot only, just it should be object oriented.
Okay, sure.
So, 6 floor are there and each floor has 2-wheeler and 4-wheeler parking, and that will decide later how much is the 2-wheeler parking and how much is the 4-wheeler parking.
Okay. Okay, so I have thought about the basic, very basic design. I have thought about there would be one interface type of thing, vehicle, and there could be multiple classes that are implementing this interface. So maybe a bus, a car that are 4-wheelers, and a bike or a cycle that are 2-wheeler, and it would have a basically this size property indicating. Like what is the size? So it is indicates just a 2-wheeler or a 4-wheeler basically to fit into the parking lot, and then there is a parking lot class. So it has to identify the spot, particular spot. It would have the capacity that we put it in the basically.
So parking lot class will have capacity.
So parking lot class defines one particular spot of the parking space. Capacity, by capacity I mean whether it is able to handle the 2-wheeler vehicle or a 4-wheeler vehicle. So this attribute matches with the attribute that I put in the vehicle class to indicate whether it is a 2-wheeler or a 4-wheeler.
Okay, so this you are saying is one parking, whether 2-wheeler or 4-wheeler.
Yeah, and it would have a
parking type class.
Sorry?
So you can say parking type.
So basically parking type is a instance variable in a parking lot class.
Okay
and
so
then
inside the parking lot class you have this parking type instance variable and which is of type
we can say that can be an enum that denotes a 2-wheeler or a 4-wheeler.
Okay,
then we would have a level indicating like what is the at which level, since there are 1 to 6 levels, we can have a level. And
so
one
again we will have enum for level.
Yeah, we can have a enum.
Okay, inside this parking lot class only, right?
The enum is outside and we are just using this enum values in, like, there is an instance variable of enum type basically.
So this instance is inside the parking lot, right?
Yeah, exactly.
Okay. So in parking lot, you have one parking type, one level. What else?
One spot number or a position which basically identifies the particular. So when we go in the parking, there are like numbers mentioned 1, 2, 2, 42.
We need not to maintain that where the vehicle is parked. We just have the, it can be parked anywhere.
Okay.
Wherever 2-wheeler parking is available. Yeah.
Okay. And size is there, level is there.
Tell me how much parking left at this particular level, and that's it.
Okay, how much parking is left? So
on a particular floor.
Okay, Okay. Yeah. So each would have just a second. I'm thinking over this.
Yeah.
Parking controller class. And okay, there would be a manager that is managing these 6 floors. Okay. Yeah, initially numbers are same. Once we book in, we make a call to this parking manager that will determine the count and it is occupied with this one. Yeah, so like I told the vehicle class and this parking lot class, which identifies a particular spot, and there would be a parking manager type class that is basically managing or maintaining the counts, like how much space is there in a particular level. What is the particular space and how much it is filled. So
one is parking type, which is saying what kind of parking it is, and one is level, so it will say what level it is.
Yeah.
And so this parking lot indicates what, the complete parking?
No. This is indicating a particular parking spot.
Parking spot. Okay. So it will say which level this parking spot is.
Yeah.
And what is the type of it. Okay.
Yeah. And then I have one more class, parking manager, which is managing all the 6 levels to have the count of like how much spots are available at a particular level. So it will maintain these counts for all the 6 levels.
So in parking manager, what instance variable will have?
One would be of parking. Okay, so it will have a hash map of the key would be the parking lot, and the value would be the count, like how much the count is available in that particular so it will have a hash map of a we can have a like parking level. So I already defined the parking level enum. So the key would be parking level, and the value would be count of how much spots are free at that particular level.
Okay. So it's a parking lot and queue.
Can you please repeat what you just said?
So it's a map of parking spot and so what is this parking lot inside queue?
No, it is a map of the level,
mm-hmm.
and the count of the value would be the count, like how much spots are particularly available at that particular level.
Okay, so this level enum that we created will
yeah.
this, that is key.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
Okay,
thanks. Basically, like once a vehicle comes in to have a parking, we can like call this parking manager to check from the first level, basically. And
so you will have operation to check inside this parking manager. You will have operation to check available parking.
Yeah, exactly.
On which floor, right?
Yeah, and it would return the first from the lowest. It would return the first particular level from.
So you will pass the level in that?
No, I am not passing. I am just passing the vehicle type.
Vehicle type we are passing, okay.
Yeah. And
what you will do then?
Then, like once a vehicle comes in, I will call this parking manager function to get the first level where I can park this particular vehicle.
Yeah, tell me the logic. So let's say what operation you want me to create?
The operation would be return first available spot.
Return available spot.
First available spot.
Okay.
And what it will do is, it will, okay. So there is one problem in this design. Actually, I am maintaining the counts of the spots. I am not maintaining the count of, okay. I have not maintained. So there is one miss in this design. Basically, I've maintained the count as overall, but the count should be actually of indicating the size. Basically, the parking type. I said the vehicle type. Sorry.
Mm-hmm.
So instead of okay, just a second. Parking type level. Okay. So basically, we can have a parking lot. We can have a one more class here, which is a combination of the level and the level and the minimum type, the level and the vehicle type. So this class is a combination of the level and the vehicle type. And this will actually be used as a key. So because like what I initially used was to have a count as a whole, but say a bike comes in and it checks like what are the spots available. So it say it gets at level 1 there are 33 spots, but it don't know whether these spots are of for 4-wheeler or for a 2-wheeler. So for this to maintain, I would need to have that class that is basically maintaining the both the level and the vehicle type. So the map that I created should be the key should be this particular class.
Okay.
And just a second. Yeah. So I was saying the key is this class, custom class, and the value is the count. So I'm maintaining basically there would be 12 key value pairs here. And like once a vehicle comes in for parking, I would make a call to return first available spot, and that basically like checks in the hash map. It iterates over the hash map and checks for
okay, we'll move ahead. I got your point.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, in Spring,
yeah.
Can you tell me some lifecycle method that you have used?
Okay. Lifecycle method. I've used the init method.
Why you use the init method?
So we had a requirement basically. Like before creating the object of a corporate action, we needed to set some default values from the DB.
Okay.
The static data that was.
Have you used Hibernate also?
No, I have not used Hibernate.
Any ORM?
In one project, I had used Spring JDBC. I don't know like how much relevant it is for you.
Okay, fine. Okay, I'm done for my side. I'll just share my feedback to HR.
Sure.
And they'll get back to you by today or tomorrow maybe.
Okay. What's your good name?
Saurabh Tiwari.
Okay, thank you, Saurabh.
Yeah, thank you. Bye.
Bye.